Good morning, one and all. So in the last class we have seen some problems based on total probability theorem and Bayes theorem. So we'll see some more problems in this regarding. So this is a problem which says that we have four boxes. Each box 1 contains 200 components, of which 5% are defective. Box 2, this much is defective. Box 3 and 4 contains this much, and 10% are defective. Select at random one of the boxes and we remove at random a single component. Okay, so we have 4 boxes. Randomly we remove one component from these 4 boxes. So there are two parts in this question. Part A, what is asking? What is the probability that the selected component is a defective one? Okay, so what the problem says, we have 4 boxes, they contain some number of balls or components. So out of them, certain percent of them are defective, remaining are perfect, good. So what is the probability that you pick up a component that is of defective type? Clear? Now, so let us solve this. Now we have 4 boxes. Let us call them as B1. Let us call them as B1, B2, B3 and B4. So let us call them as B1. This is B2. This is B3. And that is B4. This final one is B4. This is B3. Now, so box 1, box 2, box 3, box 4. Now, this box 1 total number of components are 2000. Out of which 5% are defective. Which means, so what is the 5% of 200? 100. So 100 are defective, which means remaining 1900 are good. They are good. Okay, in the same way in box 2, so 300 are good. So how many are defective? 200 are defective. Okay, so here I have written all the 4 boxes and the amount of defective components in each of the 4 boxes. So this denotes the defective components in each and every box. So first of all, I told you already, we select a component randomly from any one of these 4 boxes. Now what is the probability of selecting box B1? It will be same as the probability of selecting box B2. It will be same as the probability of selecting box 3. It will be equal to the probability of selecting box 4. So the selecting the box is equiprobable, which means we can randomly select any one of these 4 boxes. That's why all are equiprobable, which means so the probability of selecting first box equal to second box equal to third box on and equal to fourth box equal to 1/4. Now what is the question given? The question says, what is the probability that the selected component is a defective? Okay, so here what we use here, what we have to use, which theorem we have to use? We have to use what is the probability that the selective component is defective. So D is an event which says selecting the defective component. D is the event of selecting the defective component. Okay. Now, so before that, now we have some condition, we can take some conditions. What are those conditions? Okay. We can say, what is the probability that we can select a defective components from first box? What does this indicates? Given that we are getting a component from the first box, what is the probability that it is defective? This is a conditional probability which says that what is the partial information we have? We are selecting a component from first box, then what is the probability that that is will be defective? Now, if you go to the first box, total number of components are 2000. Among 2000, how many are defective? 100. So, what is the probability of getting a defective components from the first box? That is 100 by 2000. I hope it is very simple. That is 100 by 2000, which comes out to be how much? 1 by. So, these two cancel, 1 by 20. It may be 0.05. Maybe 0.05. In the same way, so what is the probability of getting a defective component from the second box? You have done with the first box, so from the second box, what is that? In the second box, we have total 500, among them 200 are defective, which means 200 by 500. How much? 200 by 500. That is 200 by 500, that is 0.4. So, what is the probability of selecting a defective from the third box? That will be same as fourth box, because they are containing same number of components, and among them they are also containing the same number of defective components. So, B3, B4, how many? Out of 1000, 100 are defective, which means 100 by 1000. 100 by 1000, that is 100 by 1000. That is, this to cancel, 1 by 10, 0.1. Now, but what we want? We want to find out what? Probability of defective components. We want to find out the probability of what? Defective components. Now, how to find out probability of defective components? What is that? Which theorem we use? Think about this. Okay. Now here you can say this B1, B2, B3, B4, they form a partition of the sample space. Okay. So if you want to write me something like that, now this is, if you take this, something like this. Maybe this is B1, B2, for example, I'm writing. So B1, B2, B3, B4, they form a partition of a sample space. Now, what we want to find out? We find out an event. What says? Defective. This is what, the event D. Okay. So how to find event D? The probability of event D is nothing but, how to find out? Probability of B1 into probability of D given B1. There are four partitions, plus probability of B2, probability of B2 into probability of D given B2. Plus probability of B3 into probability of D given B3. So on. plus probability of D for, sorry, probability of B for probability of D given B4. So now which property we are using here? What is the theorem that we are using here? What is this theorem? Total probability theorem. Okay. Now you have everything with you. So furthermore, this P of B1, P of B2, all are equal. You can take them as common, that is 1 by 4. What is P of D given B1? 0.05 plus 0.4 plus 0.1 plus 0.1. So you try to calculate this. It is 0.1625. This is the probability that you get a defective component from these four boxes. Now here, so they are the partitions of the sample space omega. You know what the partitions means. Now we have to find out any event B, any event D. You have to find out this probability. So using total probability theorem. Now what is the part B says? This is a part A. What part B says? So we examine the selected component and we find it defective. The question is, so we take out a component from the any one of the boxes, we found that it is defective. And what is the probability that it is from box 2? What is the probability that it is from box 2? Okay. So, what they are asking? You think about this. So, they take out a component from the any one of the four boxes. They found that it is defective. And they are asking, what is the probability that, part B, what is the probability that it is from the second box? What they are asking? Probability that what is known to us, it is defective. Then we want to find out what the probability that it is from the second box. It is from the second box. This is what they are asking. Okay. Now, so how to find out this? This is by using which theorem now? Bayes theorem. How to find out this? So apply the conditional probability theorem or problem property. So D intersection B2, D intersection B2 by probability of D. Correct. Now how to write down probability of D intersection B2? Furthermore, we can write furthermore, this is probability of B2 into probability of, how to find out? D given B2 by probability of D. So you go to Bayes theorem and you check the property. This is what we write. So the probability of B2 already we know. 1 by 4. This is 1 by 4 into. What is probability of D given B2? Probability of D given B2. 0.4. I'm writing 0.4 into 0.4 by. What is P of D? Just now we have found out. 0.1625. That is 0.1625. You find out this. What is the answer? Okay, so that is the probability that your box will be, your component will be from second box. The defective component is from the second box. Okay, in this problem we have used two theorems, total probability theorem and the Bayes theorem. Okay, we proceed to the next problem. Now, so before that, so this is something called air traffic controller. You might have seen these kind of structures near airports. Okay. Here, what they contain is, they contain a radar, some kind of a radar. Okay. So, what is the job of this ATC is to identify the presence of aircrafts near its vicinity. Suppose you take this ATC, it has got some radar. So the radar, it can identify or it can register the presence of aircrafts within its limits. Suppose it has got a limit of, let us take 50 kilometers. It's got limit of 50 kilometers. Okay. Now the radar will detect the presence of aircrafts within the 50 kilometers radius. Okay. It is called air traffic controller. So that is very crucial for any airport. So using this radar, they will identify the presence of aircraft. It's called radar. Radar means radio detection and ranging. So this is the job of the radar. It is used to identify the presence of aircrafts within the its limits. So it's widely used in airports. This is called air traffic controller or also called ATC. So by this ATC only, they will identify the presence of aircrafts and they'll give permission for landing and all those things. Okay. So without this ATC, it will be very difficult to operate in airport. Okay. Because we don't know where is aircraft is. Okay. So anyway, so that is something need to be studied later. Now let us proceed to our problem. So this is a problem based on radar detection. If an aircraft is present in a certain area, a radar correctly registers its presence with a probability of 0.99. Please remember, if there is an aircraft, the radar will register its presence with a probability of 0.99, very high probability. If it is not present, the radar falsely registers an aircraft's presence with a probability of 0.10. We assume that an aircraft is present with a probability of 0.05. What is the probability of a false alarm? A false alarm means what? Just look at this. These terms are very, very important. False alarm means a false indication of the aircraft's presence. And the probability of missed detection. Nothing registers even though an aircraft is present. Okay. You look at these things carefully. So I gave you the brief idea of what is radar means. Okay. It is widely used in the air traffic controllers whose job is to identify the presence of aircraft near its within its boundaries. Okay. Now what they are asking, first of all, let us take A and B are two events. What is A? An aircraft is present. Okay. Near the radar, there is an aircraft or aeroplane. Okay. What is B? The radar registers an aircraft's presence. Event A is there is an aeroplane. Event B means, so the radar will register its presence. Okay. Now let us consider their complements. Complements of what? A and B. What do they say? What is A complement? What is A? An aircraft is present. What is A complement? Aircraft is not present. What is event B? The radar registers the presence of an aircraft. What is the complement of that? The radar does not register the presence of an aircraft. Okay. Now, so what they're asking? What is the probability of false alarm? What is the false alarm means? So, what is a false alarm? A false indication of the aircraft's presence, which means an aircraft is not present even though the radar registers its presence. That is called false alarm, which means even though there is no aircraft, our radar is identifying the presence of aircraft. That is called false alarm. Nothing is there, but we are getting an indication that there is an aircraft. That is a false thing, right? Now, what is a missed detection? missed detection means there is aircraft, but our radar could not identify the presence of an aircraft. What is that? An aircraft is present and the radar does not register the presence of an aircraft. Okay. Now, if you write in terms of events, what would you write? The probability of false alarm would be, what would you write? Probability that an aircraft is not present, which means A complement, and the radar registers the presence of an aircraft, which means what? The radar registers an aircraft present means A complement intersection B. That is nothing but the probability of false alarm. What about the probability of missed detection? Probability that an aircraft is not present. An aircraft is present, which means A, and the radar does not register the presence of an aircraft, means the radar does not register the presence of an aircraft, means A into B complement. So these two things we need to find out. In order to find out, so the probability of false alarm and the probability of misdetection. So which property will you use? You can call it as a conditional probability, you can call it as a multiplication rule. Before that, what is given in the data? What is given in the problem? So let me write here. What is given? First of all, we assume that an aircraft is present with a probability of 0.05, means what? The probability of the presence of an aircraft is P of A, that is 0.05. Obviously, what the probability that the aircraft is not present? A complement. Obviously, what will be that? You know already. So P of A plus P of A complement should be equal to 1, which means this should be 1 minus 0.05, that is 0.95. Correct? Isn't it? Now what else is given? So this is over. This data, we have used it. And what about this 0.99? What does this indicate? What does 0.10 indicates? Can you guess? Okay. Anyway, so let us go to the problem first. So I will write everything in the sequential order. Okay. This is sequential tree. This is called sequential tree. Suppose this is here, let us take present P of A. The aircraft is present. Okay. Now, what the probability? 0.0. What is the probability of that? 0.05. The probability? 0.05. Now, two things may happen. If there is an aircraft, there can be two possibilities. What are they? Probability that what are they? B given A. Here probability that B complement given A. Two things are possible now. If there is an aircraft, correct? Two things may happen. What are they? The radar may register its presence. The radar may not register its presence. What do this indicates? An aircraft is present. Given that, the radar registers its presence. Okay. Let us go to the problem one more time. Now, if an aircraft is present in certain area, the radar correctly registers its presence with a probability of 0.99. What that is indicate? So if there is an aircraft and the radar will identify its presence with a probability 0.99. means, so this is given by 0.99. that is given by 0.99. okay, what does it indicate? So the radar will identify the presence of an aircraft given that an aircraft is present. Obviously, what this will be? So this is a complement of this. How much this should be? 0.01. 1 minus this. 1 minus 0.99, that is 0.01. What does this mean? So given that an aircraft is present, but the radar does not identify the presence of an aircraft, is given by 0.11. Now, so second case, probability of A complement. What is that? 0.95. Means here no aircraft. Here there is an aircraft. In the second case also, there are two possibilities. What are they? Probability that, so P given A complement, and one more probability is probability that B complement given A complement. Isn't it? So what is given in the problem? Now, if it is not present, the radar falsely registers an aircraft presence with a probability 0.10. What does this indicate? Read this sentence carefully. Even though there is no aircraft, the radar will identify its presence. Means, what is given in the problem? Even though there is no aircraft, the radar will identify the presence of aircraft. It is given. In the problem, this is given. How much is given? So, it is given as 0.10. 0.10. Obviously, this should be 1 minus of 0.10, 0.90. Okay. This is a sequential tree which indicates all possibilities. First of all, if there is an aircraft, two possibilities. If there is no aircraft, also two possibilities. Okay. So finally, what do you want? What do you want finally? Finally, you want P of A intersection B complement and P of A complement intersection B. First of all, false alarm. Probability of false alarm. The probability of false alarm. What is that? Probability that an aircraft is not present. Even though aircraft is not present, it is identified by the radar. Now, how to find out this? We use the probability of multiplication rule, or we can use the conditional probability rule. What you can say? What you can write? Probability of A complement intersection B. What do you know? Probability of B given A complement into probability of A complement. You can write in this way, right? What is probability of B given A complement? B given A complement. 0.10. 0.10. 0.10 into what is the probability of A complement? 0.95. Okay, you find out that and you will get the answer. 0.095. Next, what is they asking? The probability of misdetection. Misdetection. means what they are asking, probability that there is an aircraft and it is not identified by the radar, which means probability of P complement given A into probability of A. What is the B complement given A? 0.10. That is 0.10 into what is probability of A? 0.05. So what is B given, B complement given A? 0.01. This is 0.01 into what is P of A? 0.05. That is 0.05. What that is? 0.0005. Okay, so this is what we have. Now, so these two, this is what we indicate as a P of A into P of B complement given A. Multiply these two directly. 0.05, this is 0.01. What do you get? Misdetection. Misdetection. Now what did this says? Probability of A complement into probability of B given A complement. This one. So this is what the, this indicates false alarm. Okay. In this way we can solve more number of problems. Okay, so that is about some problems we have discussed based on the multiplication rule, conditional probability, Bayes theorem and total probability. Okay, I'll give an assignment few more problems. So let us move on to another topic. What is topic now? Independence. So when can you say two events are independent of each other? So two events A and B are said to be independent if the probability of A intersection B is equal to the probability of A into the probability of B, or otherwise probability of A given B equal to probability of A. What does it mean? Okay. Anyway, so these two are related. We can derive the second one from the first one itself. Okay. Otherwise, so what is the probability of A given B? General formula equal to probability of intersection B by probability of B. But if they are independent, what is the probability of A intersection B? Probability of A into probability of B. So which means the probability of A into probability of B by probability of B. So we are left with the probability of A. Okay. Now obviously the second condition is, so these are two conditions which indicates two events are independent. Now here the probability of B should never be zero. Why? If it is zero, what happens? Now the it becomes undefined. Otherwise here the probability of P should be always positive. It should never be zero. Okay, that is the condition need to be satisfied. Yeah, what do you mean by that independence? Okay, so the outcome of event A has no effect on the outcome of event B. Independence is established by priori by reasoning that outcome of an experiment 1 or experiment A have no effect on the outcome of experiment 2 or experiment B, you can say. So the outcome of event A has no effect on the outcome of event B, then they are said to be independent. So independence is symmetric, which means A is independent of B, which also means B is independent of A. It is symmetric property. So A and B are independent of each other. When they are said to be independent, when this is satisfied, when that is satisfied. Okay, that is very, very important. Now, so here, this is the physical way of saying independence. When an event A has no effect on event B, then they are said to be independent of each other. So let us take a simple example to verify whether two events are independent or not. What the first thing? Consider an experiment involving two successive rolls of a four-sided die in which all 16 possible outcomes are equally likely and have a probability of 1 by 16. That is quite obvious. I am taking two parts, part A and part B. What is the part A? Our events, A equal to the first roll is a 1, B equal to sum of two rolls is a 5, independent. So an experiment, I got two events. I am asking whether these two events are independent or not. First of all, so we are rolling a four-sided die or D4 die successively two times, and the total number of outcomes are 16. The sample space contains 16 elements. Obviously, all elements are equally likely or equiprobable, which means so the probability of each and every outcome of an experiment is 1 by 16. Now we have two events. What is event A? The first roll is a 1. If you roll a die for the first time, you may get 1. What is event B? The sum of two rolls is a 5. The sum of two rolls is a 5. Now, so let us find event A and event B separately. Okay. Let us find event A and event B separately. So what event A contains and what event B contains. Okay. So first roll is a 1 and the sum of two rolls is a 5. So let us solve the part A. Part A. Event A says first roll is a 1. What are the possibilities? So you're rolling the die two times. First time you should get 1, which means second time also you may get 1. First time you get 1, which means second time you get 2. First time you may get 1. Second time you may get 3. First time you may get 1. Second time you may get 4. 4 possibilities. Before that, so what is the sample space? It has got 16 elements. You know what are those 16 elements. I told you in the last class itself. You go and verify. Okay. Now what the probability of A now? What the probability of A? So number of elements in A by total number of possible outcomes. Total number of possible outcomes. Here, the number of elements of A. How many are there? 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 by the number of the total number of possible outcomes. How many? 16. So this is 1 by 4. Okay. Now what event B says? Event B says The sum is 5. The sum is 5. What are the possibilities? The sum of two rolls need to be 5. You get 1, you may get 4. What is sum? 5. Or you may get 4, you may get 1. What is sum? 5. You may get 2 or 3. Or you may get 3 or 2. Is it D4 die? So any other possibilities? Only 4. The possibilities are only 4. Okay. Now here also. So what is the probability of B? So the number of elements of B by the total number of possible outcomes of the experiment. 4 by 16. Again, that is also 4 by 16. So the probability of B also equal to 4 by 16, that equal to 1 by 4. Now I am asking, what is the, before that, what is A intersection B? How many elements are common in A and B? How many are common? A and B, you just check A and B, how many are common? Yeah. Here 1, 4. Here also 1, 4. Okay. Any other? Any other common elements? So if there are any other common elements, you can verify. If not, we'll stop here. Okay, only one. There is only one common element between events A and B. What is that? What is that? 1, 4. Now what is the probability of A intersection B? The number of elements in A intersection B, only one, by the total number of elements in the sample space, that is 1 by 16. Now, so let us verify. So the probability of A intersection B, that equal to 1 by 16, that is also equal to the probability of A into the probability of B. What is the probability of A? 1 by 4. What is the probability of B? Also 1 by 4. That is also 1 by 16. Now it is satisfied. The property is satisfied. Now we say that they are independent. Because the probability of A intersection B is same as the probability of A into probability of B. Okay. That is part A. Now, so let us go to part B. What part B says? So the maximum of two roles is 2, the minimum of two roles is 2. Event A is the maximum of two roles is 2 and the minimum of two roles is 2. Yeah. So let us write the events. Event A. What is event A? Maximum of two roles is 2. Maximum of two roles is 2. Maximum is 2. What are the possibilities? If you roll a die successively 2 times, you should get maximum 2. Yeah. What are the possibilities? 1, 2, here maximum is 2. 2, 1, maximum is 2. 2, 2, the maximum is 2. Any other possibilities? Any other possibilities? The maximum is 2 means these are only possibilities. Now here, what is the probability of A? The number of elements in A, 3, by total possible elements, 16. Okay. Now what is event B says? Event B says minimum 2. What are the possibilities? Minimum 2 means 2, 3, 24 32 and 42. Any other possibilities? Check verify. Yeah, obviously 22 will be there anyway. Any other possibilities? Check and verify. So in all these possibilities, the minimum of two outcomes is 2. Here, what is the minimum? 2. Minimum 2. Minimum 2. Minimum 2. Minimum 2. So what is the probability of B? Number of elements in B. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. By total elements are 16. 5 by 16. Now here itself I am asking you, A intersection B, how many are there? You check. A intersection B. So A intersection B, how many are in common? Here 2, 2. This is where, here also it is there, 2, 2. Any other common elements? 1, 2 is not there, 2, 1 is also not there, only 1. What is that? 2, 2. What is the probability of this? It should be 1 by 16. Now here you can observe. So the probability of A intersection B, that is 1 by 16, and the probability of A into the probability of B, how much? Equal to probability of A is how much? 3 by 16. This is 3 by 16. Probability of B is 5 by 16. The probability of B is 5 by 16. So 3 by 16 into 5 by 16. So here you can clearly see that. So the probability of A intersection B is not equal to, is not equal to probability of A into the probability of B, which means not independent, not independent, not independent. Otherwise, you can also call them as dependent. You can also call them as dependent. Not independents, or you can also call them as dependent. Okay. Now here, what you got? So they are independent. The first two events are independent, and they are not independent, or they are dependent. Which means in the first part, the occurrence of A has no effect on occurrence of B. Okay, which means in the event B, in the second part, so occurrence of A has effect on occurrence of B. Why? How can you visualize these things? The maximum of two roles is 2. The maximum of two roles is 2. Which means, so here, so here 1, 2. Maximum of two roles is 2. Here 1, 2. Okay. So what is the minimum of two roles is 2? Let us take 2, 1. Okay. Now here If the minimum is 2, what you can say here? If minimum is 2, maximum cannot be 2. Isn't it? Otherwise, let me put in this way. Suppose if the minimum is 2, obviously, if the minimum of two roles is 2, maximum cannot be 2. Correct? That's why they affect each other. So these two events have effect on each other. If minimum is 2, maximum cannot be 2. Correct? Suppose minimum is 2. Let us take 3, 2 example. What is the minimum? 2. But it will not be present in the event A, because what is the maximum here? Maximum 2, maximum 3. Okay? If the minimum is 2, the maximum cannot be 2. That's why they have effect on each other. They are not independent, they are dependent. Okay. Now, so I will start this one more concept, that is conditional independence. So till now we have seen conditional probability. In the same way, conditional independence. Two events A and B are said to be conditionally independent given another event C. What is C? P of C is greater than 0 if probability of A intersection B given C equal to the probability of A given C into the probability of B given C. You can prove this in the simplest way. This is the this equality which need to be satisfied for the conditional independence. What is that? The probability of A intersection B given C should be equal to the probability of A given C into probability of B given C. So we'll study these statements later. Independence does not imply conditional independence and vice versa, which means if A and B are independent, does not mean that they are conditionally independent. Please, this is very, very important. If A and B are independent, it does not mean that they are conditionally independent, vice versa. Vice versa means if A and B are conditionally independent, it does not mean that they will also be independent. Okay, so we'll take some problems to justify this sentence. Okay, so you try to solve this problem. So we are tossing two fair coins. H1 is an event which indicates the first toss is a head. H2 is second toss is a head. D is the two tosses have different results. Okay. The first is head means what is H1 could be? Possibility of H1. Anyway, before that, so the sample space will have four elements. What are they? Head, head, tail, tail head, tail tail. Okay. So if all are equiprobable, so the probability of getting head head same as tail tail same as how much? So 1/4. Anyway, first toss is a head means what are the possibilities? First is head, second may also be head. If first is head, second may be tail. What is the probability of H1? What is that? The number of elements in H1, that is 2, by the total possible outcomes 4, that is 1/2. Now H2, the second toss is head. Second is head, first may be head. If second is head, first may be tail. What is the probability? P of H2 is also what? 1/2. No need to mention each and every time. Now, what is D? So the two tosses have different results. Means you should not get same result in each and every toss. Means first time you may get head, second time you may get tail, or tail head. Here also what the probability of D? Also 1/2. Now you got these three events and their corresponding probabilities. Okay. Now, so I want to ask you one important question. What is H1 intersection H2? What is H1 intersection H2? What is that? HH. H1 intersection H2 is HH. Now, so we go to big O here. Now, can you tell me what is probability that H1 intersection H2, given that event D? What is this probability? Can you tell me? H1 intersection H2 is having only one element. What is that? HH. What is that? HH. And what is D? The two tosses have different results. Okay. Here H1, H2 as result only one, that is HH. Given that D, what D says? Different results. Now can you tell me what is this probability? So in the H1 intersection H2, we have only one element, that is HH. Both are same. Given that D means what? Both are different. What is the probability? It is 0. So I'll give homework. You find out probability that H1 intersection D, and find out probability that H2 given D. Sorry, find out probability that H1 given D and probability that H2 given D. You find out these two and compare with this, and whether this is a conditionally independent or not. Okay. So we are running out of time. We stop here. Thank you.